जनगणमन अधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड उत्कल वंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्चल जलधि तरंगा तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तव जय गाथा जनगण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे
హానరబుల్ శ్రీ జస్టిస్ ఎన్వి రమణ గారు, జడ్జ్ హానరబుల్ సుప్రీం కోర్ట్ ఆఫ్ ఇండియా అండ్ హానరబుల్ విజిటర్ హానరబుల్ శ్రీ జస్టిస్ అరూప్ కుమార్ గోస్వామి, చీఫ్ జస్టిస్ హానరబుల్ హైకోర్ట్ ఆఫ్ ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్ అండ్ హానరబుల్ ఛాన్సలర్, హానరబుల్ మెంబర్స్ ఆఫ్ దామోదరం సంజీవయ్య నేషనల్ యూనివర్సిటీ జనరల్ కౌన్సిల్, ఎగ్జిక్యూటివ్ కౌన్సిల్, అకాడమిక్ కౌన్సిల్, ప్లానింగ్ అండ్ మానిటరింగ్ బోర్డ్, ఫైనాన్స్ కమిటీ, ఇన్ఫ్రాస్ట్రక్చర్ మానిటరింగ్ అండ్ డెవలప్మెంట్ కమిటీ, ఫ్యాకల్టీ, ద గ్రాడ్యుయేటింగ్ స్టూడెంట్స్, పేరెంట్స్, మీడియా ఫ్రెండ్స్ అండ్ ఇన్వైటీస్, గుడ్ ఆఫ్టర్నూన్ అండ్ హార్టీ వెల్కమ్ టు ఆల్ ఆఫ్ యూ టు ద 4th, 5th, 6th and 7th వర్చువల్ కాన్వకేషన్ ఆఫ్ దామోదరం సంజీవయ్య నేషనల్ యూనివర్సిటీ విశాఖపట్నం. యాజ్ యు నో, వీ ఆల్ హ్యావ్ వర్చువల్లీ అసెంబ్ల్డ్ హియర్ టుడే ఆన్ ద మెమరబుల్ అకేషన్ అండ్ ఇట్ ఈస్ మొమెంటస్ డే ఫర్ ఆల్ ఆఫ్ అస్ for the gracious presence of Honorable Sri Justice N.V. Ramana Garu, Judge Supreme Court of India and Honorable Visitor DSNLU. I welcome you, sir, and we look forward to having your advice and blessings on this great occasion. I warmly welcome Honorable Sri Justice Arup Kumar Goswami, Chief Justice Honorable High Court of Andhra Pradesh and Chancellor DSNLU, who is the source of inspiration for all of us for gracing this occasion to confer the degrees. I also welcome honorable guests virtually present here for this occasion. As we are all aware, the nation and the world have witnessed the pandemic caused by the COVID-19, also called Wuhan virus. The deadly virus caused havoc in all human activities, and education sector is not an exception. The academic activity in DSNLU also has been disturbed due to this pandemic. The university closed all physical activities since March 2020, but the will to face this challenge enabled the university to continue virtual classes and webinars with all your support. It is customary to present the annual report on all activities of the university. I take this opportunity to place the annual report before this august body. The university was established in 2008 as Andhra Pradesh University of Law, later renamed as Damodaram Sanjeevaya National Law University. The university offers 5 years integrated BA/LLB honors, LLM, PhD and LLD programs, mainly focusing on quality legal education. It is also a great pleasure to inform you that DSNLU is ranked 9th best law university by India Today in 2020 and also stood 7th at the national level as the best law school under the best living and learning category by the Careers 360 magazine ranks in 2021. Recently, DSNLU received the ISO certificate for extending qualitative services and best academic practices. In the academic front, university has been regularly organizing guest lectures to equip the students with world-class exposure by inviting legal luminaries, sitting and former judges of the Supreme Court and High Courts, academicians and practicing advocates and other experts in social sciences. The university established various centers for research and training to help the students to develop their research acumen by offering in-depth study in specialized areas. Many committees like moot court advocacy and mediation, library advisory committee, literary and debating committee, internship committee, legal cell, etc. are constituted to promote the academic and professional skills of the students and also motivate them to work for social cause. DSNLU is committed to promote academic excellence and in this process organized many national and international programs, webinars, and to name a few, APJ Abdul Kalam National IPR Quiz, 5th and 6th Damodaram Sanjeevaya National Moot Court Competitions, International Human Rights Day Celebrations and Challenges to Law and Technology in 21st Century, Super International Conference on Superpowers Dominion in Outer Space and Global Sustainable Development, Seminar on Gandhiji Naye Talim, Child Rights and International Labor Organization conducted on the eve of completion of 100 years of ILO, International Conference on Immanuel Kant and Transformative Justice are the few national and international programs to cite here for the audience. And the university also conducted many virtual lectures during this COVID pandemic by professors from Yale University, University of Queensland, University of Northern Carolina, Cornell University and Washington University. To promote research skills of faculty and students, DSNLU has organized training programs, workshops on new education policy, etc. The students of DSNLU brought laurels to the university by winning many national and international moot court competitions. To name a few, best memorial title in the 5th Anand Swarup Gupta International Memorial Moot Court Competition 2021, first at the national level and reached 4th position in 13th International Criminal Court Competition 2020 Asia Pacific Friendly Rounds, I am Nanavati Memorial National Moot Court Competition, National Mock Trial 2020, Tila International Moot Court Competition on Energy Laws 2019, Client Counseling Competition 2020, Corporate Restructuring Competition, SK Puri Memorial International Moot Court Competition 2019, Best Speaker at SARC Law JLC Moot Court Competition 2020, Third Best Memorial of Philip C. Jessup International Moot Court Competition 2020 at Amity Law School, Noida, Corporate Restructuring Competition held at Symbiosis Law School, Hyderabad, Best Memorial Award at SK Puri International Moot Court Competition, Geetham Regional Moot Court Competition, Runners Up at DiRoggio Memorial Debate 2019 at Presidency University, Kolkata, Ramaya Inter University Debate at Ramaya School of Law, Bengaluru, and many more prestigious moot court competitions. The students left their indelible imprints at national and international competitions from time to time. Besides academic pursuits, students of DSNLU are in the forefront in extracurricular activities and registered their stellar performances at Viraj 2019, a sports fest conducted by National Law University Odisha, and bagged many gold, silver and bronze medals. Academic strength of a university is its academic and professional contacts with many national and international institutions. DSNLU entered MOUs with many national universities to facilitate faculty and student exchange programs and provide opportunities to the students to study one semester in those universities. At international level, DSNLU has MOUs with Vistula University, Poland and Indo-European Center. The university administration, with the support of Honorable Visitor, Honorable Chancellor, members of various committees, faculty, supporting staff, students and government, is making every effort to make this university a center of excellence to attain greater academic heights. I am happy to announce that DSNLU is celebrating the birth centenary celebrations of Sri Damodaram Sanjeevayya in 2021. There will be year-long academic programs, competitions and lectures to mark the occasion. Sri Damodaram Sanjeevayya was the youngest and the first Dalit chief minister in India, and he has immensely contributed to the people of India as Minister for Labour Welfare in Government of India, and also in particular he rendered great services to the people of Andhra Pradesh. Today the virtual convocation confers degrees BLLB honours to 4 batches and LLM degrees and also 4 PhDs and 2 LLDs to scholars and students from all over India. At this juncture, I congratulate and convey my best wishes to all of you who are graduating from Damodaram Sanjeevayya National University, and also thank one and all for your virtual presence. Thank you. Jai Hind. Chancellor sir, I have the honor to request you to declare the convocation open.
This 4th, 5th, 6th and 7th convocation of the Damodaram Sanjeevayya National Law University, Visakhapatnam, has been called to confer the degrees upon the candidates who, in examinations held for the purpose, have been found qualified for receiving their respective degrees. I now declare the convocation open. Do you sincerely promise and declare that, if admitted to the degrees for which you are candidates and for which you have been recommended, you will, in your daily life and conversation, conduct yourselves as worthy members of this university?
Chancellor sir, I have the honor to present to you the candidates for the degree of Doctor of Laws. They have been found qualified for the degree to which I pray they may be admitted.
By virtue of the authority vested in me as the Chancellor of this university, I admit you to the degree of Doctor of Laws.
Chancellor sir, I have the honor to present to you the candidates for the degree of Doctor of Philosophy. They have been found qualified for the degree to which I pray that they may be admitted.
By virtue of the authority vested in me as the Chancellor of this university, I admit you to the degree of Doctor of Philosophy.
Chancellor sir, I have the honor to present to you the candidates for the degree of Master of Laws. They have been found qualified for the degree to which I pray they may be admitted.
By virtue of the authority vested in me as the Chancellor of this university, I admit you to the degree of Master of Laws.
Chancellor sir, I have the honor to present to you the candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Arts and Laws. They have been found qualified for the degree to which I pray they may be admitted.
By virtue of the authority vested in me as the Chancellor of this university, I admit you to the degree of Bachelor of Arts and Laws, Honours. Thank you.
Chancellor sir, I have the honor to request you to decorate the students who have exhibited outstanding performance, commanding the award of instituted medals and prizes for the 4th, 5th, 6th and 7th convocation respectively.
Medals to the respective candidates for their outstanding academic performance in the examinations conducted by the university may be awarded. I now request Honorable Sri Justice N.V. Ramana, Judge, Honorable Supreme Court of India, and Honorable Visitor, Damodaram Sanjeevaya National Law University, to kindly deliver the convocation address.
Dear Chancellor, Vice Chancellor, Registrar, members of the General Council, Executive Council, Academic Council, Finance Committee, Infrastructure Monitoring and Development Committee, Planning and Monitoring Board of the University, learned faculty members, successful students and scholars receiving degrees, ladies and gentlemen. I was supposed to speak at this event last year physically, but due to the onset of the COVID pandemic, the convocation was postponed. But I am glad that I am speaking this year, as it is the birth centenary of Sri Damodaram Sanjeevaya, the former Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh and the Minister of Labour for the Government of India. This law university is named after him, and I believe that everyone could learn from his exemplary life about the values and service to the people. I would like to recount a famous anecdote about Sri Sanjeevaya, which I believe highlights his values perfectly. When Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru was considering Sri Damodaram Sanjeevaya as the Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh, many leaders who could not digest his decision sent multiple complaints that he was highly corrupt and earned millions of rupees. Pandit Nehru told one of his intimate friends to conduct a secret and submit a report to him. The central leader landed in Hyderabad and went to Sanjeevaya's native place and with the local leader. The local leader made their car stop in front of a small straw hut at the outskirts of the village, where an old lady was cooking with a clay pot using firewood. This was Sri Sanjeevaya's mother. When she was informed about the fact that Sanjeevaya was being considered for chief minister, she was very happy. She had just one question for the central leader: will my son able to buy a coal burning stove for me now? It is very difficult to cook using firewood at my age. The leader from Delhi was dumbstruck. He told the local leader, "There is no need for further inquiry. Let us go back." After 1 week, Damodaram Sanjeevaya took oath as the first Dalit chief minister of an Indian state. As a chief minister, he used to travel to the state assembly in a rickshaw. Damodaram Sanjeevaya was a man of integrity and with multifaceted personality. He was a selfless politician responsible for many path-breaking initiatives, including setting up of the Anti-Corruption Bureau to check corruption in government offices. He strived for transparent and corruption-free administration. When he died of heart attack, he left only 3 assets: clothes, a plate and a glass. It is unfortunate that today there are hardly any politician allowed like him. He was truly a gem of a man. Dear young friends, today marks an important day in your life and a significant milestone in our journey. Convocation is a joyous and fulfilling occasion. As young graduates, you are about to embark on an extraordinary journey and create your own life adventure. Students all over the world wait for this big day. It is a moment of pride, not only for the university, but for you, your parents, faculty, and each and every person who was a part of shaping your life so far. I congratulate and extend my best wishes to each and everyone. Like many of you, I was a first generation graduate from my village. I come from a rural background, and I remember how we struggled to educate ourselves in those days. When I compare my student days to that of the present generation, I feel that all of you are so very fortunate. Facilities and unlimited access to a world of information. With your knowledge and enthusiasm, you can create ideas and innovate and thereby improve the existing methods, systems, and the society as a whole. Remember that while new ways of thinking may invite criticism, if you believe in something and work to achieve it, you can effect meaningful change. You should have a constructive attitude and attempt to determine solutions. And as said by former British Prime Minister Winston Churchill, I quote, "A pessimist sees the difficulty in every opportunity. An optimist sees the opportunity in every difficulty," unquote. I can assure the young graduates that you adopt this approach, sky is no more the limit. It is the responsibility of teachers and institutions to train students, prepare them to participate in nation building, which should be the one of the main aims of education. This brings me to what I believe the ultimate purpose of education should be. It is to combine perception and patience, emotion and intellect, substance and morals. As said by Martin Luther King Jr., I quote, "The function of education is to teach one to think intensively and to think critically. Intelligence plus character, that is the goal of true education," unquote. The education system is currently not equipped to build the character of our students, to develop a social consciousness and responsibility. Students are often caught in the rat race. All of us should therefore make a collective effort to revamp the education system to ensure that students can have the right outlook to their career and life outside. The great Justice Holmes, a former US Supreme Court judge, once stated that the life of law is not logic but experience. The seemingly simple statement imbibes the idea that to understand the law, its functioning and effect, it is necessary to be socially conscious. Today's law graduates, all of you who are here, are tomorrow's lawyers and judges. To uphold justice in all its facets, an activity that lawyers and judges grapple with every day, one must be aware of the challenges and problems the society and of the contemporary times. A theoretical understanding of the law is an incomplete understanding of it. As any new graduate who enters the profession understands soon after starting their practice, it is this divide between the theory and practice that the best type of legal education attempts to bridge. The goal of a law school is to make a law graduate socially relevant and technically sound. They must be social engineers, because law is considered as an instrument of social change. Law graduates have to inculcate analytical skills, critical evaluation, and creative solutions to legal problems. The multiple avenues available to a legal professional in today's world, where they be lawyers, legal executives, arbitrators, mediators, solicitors, and judges, necessitate a broad-based education with a focus on developing the skills of students. Law students have to be able to explain their point clearly and precisely with flawless communication skills. They have to maintain integrity of character and be prepared to work under stressful and difficult characters, circumstances. They must be prepared to work hard. Only those who work with dedication will reach the zenith in the legal profession. In order to further their practical knowledge, law school should expose students to clinical education through Lok Adalats, legal aid centers, and arbitration and mediation centers. Students should actively work with the legal service authorities, as it would give them the opportunity to work closely with the justice delivery system. We have more than 1500 law schools and law colleges in the country. Nearly 1.50 lakh students graduates from these universities, including the 23 national law universities. This is a truly astounding number. This demonstrates that the concept of the legal profession is a rich man's profession is coming to an end, and people from all walks of life are now entering the profession because of the number of opportunities and increasing availabilities of legal education in the country. But as is often the case, quality over quantity. Please don't think this wrongly. But what proportion of graduates who are fresh out of colleges are actually ready for or prepared for the profession? I would think less than 25%. This is in no way a comment on the graduates themselves, who certainly possesses the required attributes to be successful lawyers. Rather, it is a comment on the large number of substandard legal education institutions in the country, which are colleges merely in name. There are many substandard colleges in the country, which is a very worrying trend. The judiciary has taken a note of this and is attempting to correct the same. One of the consequences of the poor quality of legal education in the country is the exploding pendency in the country. There are nearly 3.8 crore cases pending in all the courts in India, despite the large number of advocates in the country. Of course, this number must be seen in the context of the around 130 crore population of India. It is also shows the faith that people repose in the judiciary. We must also keep in mind that even cases that are filed only yesterday become a part of the statistic regarding pendency. That said, I believe that students should be made to understand from the very beginning about the true duty of a lawyer, which is to unite people. Lawyers can play an important role in reducing the pendency by advising their clients to settle their disputes at the pre-litigation stage itself. They could also give proper advice to their clients as to how to pursue their legal claims without abusing the process. They must keep in mind not only their duty to their clients, but also their duty to the courts, to the society, and to the law. I would also like to take this opportunity to request all of you to use the skill you have learned and developed over your time at this university to further the rule of law. The most vulnerable are often the victims of human rights atrocities by either the state or by antisocial elements. As young advocates, you are best placed to strongly oppose the same through legal action. You must be the conscience bearers of the nation. Educate people as to their rights and provide legal guidance whenever you can. These are heavy burdens to bear, but I am sure you are all strong enough to bear it. Remember the words of Mahatma Gandhi. I quote, "Silence becomes cowardice when occasion demands speaking out the whole truth and acting accordingly," unquote. Being the drivers of social change, a heavy burden falls on your youth today to raise their voice on behalf of those rendered voiceless. Though you determine efforts, you can empower communities both locally and globally. Remember, your voice matters. I advise you all from this podium to look at the society from where you have come and at the nation which has invested all its hope in you. I urge you to rely on our culture, time-tested values, and the wisdom of our great philosophers. You should never forget the noble values of caring and sharing, of service and sacrifice that have kept our society together and enabled it to flourish. The hallmark of a civilized individual is to give back to society. You should work ethically, and wholeheartedly in our own chosen field to enhance the public good. We have to make the whole world and the future generation proud of our country through your actions and enhance the prestige of the country internationally. I would like to remind you of the words of the poet Khalil Gibran. I quote, "I slept and I dreamed that life is all joy. I woke up and I saw that life is all service. I served and I saw that service is joy," unquote. You are the stewards of this nation and custodians of a very rich tradition. I hope that you contribute in giving back something to this society, to this great nation which has bestowed you with so many privileges. Once again, I congratulate each and every one and I wish you success in all your future endeavors. God bless you and have a happy life ahead.
Chancellor sir, I have the honor to request you to declare the convocation closed.
I declare the convocation closed.
Jana Gana Mana Adhinayaka Jaya Hind Bharat Bhagya Vidhata Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravida Utkala Vanga Vindhya Himachala Yamuna Ganga Uchchala Jaladhi Taranga Tava Shubha Naame Jaage Tava Shubha Aashish Maage Gaahe Tava Jaya Gaatha Jana Gana Mangala Dayaka Jaya He Bharat Bhagya Vidhata Jaya He Jaya He Jaya He Jaya 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 He